Good morning, everybody. Hopefully you had a wonderful weekend. There's some fun information to go over today. So first thing, though, we want to let you know is the book, Who's on Your Side, has been updated, and it's called Get Comfortable, The Essential Guide to a Stress-Free Retirement. It's on the homepage at the bottom. It's still $395 as it was before, so that price hasn't gone up in, I think, 7-8 years. So if you order it through us, it's $395. If you order it through Amazon, it's, I think, $13. So that's been updated with all the new laws, all the new things that have happened, et cetera. So those of you that want to use the book as a proof that you are a great advisor because you're covering the 21 different things covered in the book, that is now available and updated. So that's information for you guys. Now, today's call is about the fact that do clients believe what we say, guys, or prospect? Clients do. Do prospects believe what we say? Yeah, no. Now, the Greatest Generation did, because they thought if you wore a suit and tie, drove a nice car, and you called yourself an advisor, they could believe you. But boomers, millennials, Generation X, and every other generation going forward, do they believe us? No, they don't. Now, and here's what happens to a lot of advisors. It pisses me off when people don't believe me. Why the heck would I lie about it? You're wondering, I'm just there to help. Do they think you're just there to help? No. What do they think you're there for? Yeah, to make a sale. And it amazes me how many advisors I'll talk to and they think, well, I don't understand. I mean, I don't know why I have to jump through the 21-point checklist. I don't know why I have to use motivational interviewing, because I'm just there to help. Now, when the client doesn't believe you, do they say, you're a liar, I don't believe you? Is that how they react? No. What goes on? And when you don't believe somebody, when you don't believe a car salesman, and you don't believe somebody that's trying to sell you something, do you yell at them and say, I don't believe you? No. It's just that in your head, what happens? Now, I need to think about it. That's exactly it. But in their head, they say, I don't trust you. So all I need to think about is their nice way of saying, I don't trust you, I need to get out of here. So we have to understand that people don't believe us. So to go from them not believing us and not trusting us to them moving all their money to us in 3 meetings, that's darn near a miracle. So how come we can do that then? How can we get them to go from not believing us, not trusting us, to get them to moving all of their money to us? How can we do that? Ah, very good, David. Nick, you guys are so smart, because they tell themselves. Exactly right. They tell themselves. People don't want to hear the truth because they don't want their illusions destroyed. When I was making $50,000 a year, those people knew after they got I got done with them, they knew they were stupid. They knew I was smart. They knew they were getting screwed, and they didn't move their money to me. Why? Because then it would burst their bubble. They'd have to admit that they were idiots. Does anybody want to admit that they're stupid or that they're wrong? No, they don't. So you can't just tell people that they're doing things wrong, that their guy is screwing them. They have to tell themselves. Now, who knows who this guy is? He's my hero. Who's this guy? David knows. Guess only David knows. It's Carl Sagan. So Carl Sagan, yeah, very, very good. Ron knows. So I want to play you something about, you know, are there flat earth? I hope there's no flat earthers on the call, or maybe I just offended you if you are a flat earther. But are there flat earthers out there who believe the world is flat? Yes, there are. And if you tell them that the world is round and you show them pictures, you give them proof, what do they say? No, that proof is wrong. See? So I want to show you how you can take somebody who, and if you tell them, it does not work. But Carl does a fantastic job with a couple of sticks and some cardboard to prove that the world is round. So I want to just walk through. Now, is he going to lecture us? No. Guess what he's going to do? What's he going to do? Lecture us? make us realize, yep, he's going to have us discover for ourselves, and he's going to do it through lecturing or through a story? Through a story. Stories are so powerful. That's why we use them with the 5 Q system. So let's walk, listen to what he, how he does it here. Oops, I'm going to get out of here.
This tower may have been a communications tower, part of a network running along the North African coast by which signal bonfires were used to communicate messages of state. It also may have been used as a lighthouse, a navigational beacon for sailing ships out there in the Mediterranean Sea. It is about 50 kilometers west of what was once one of the great cities of the world, Alexandria. In Alexandria, at that time, there lived a man named Eratosthenes. One of his envious contemporaries called him Beta, the second letter of the Greek alphabet, because, he said, Eratosthenes was second best in the world in everything. But it seems clear that in many fields, Eratosthenes was alpha. He was an astronomer, historian, geographer, philosopher, poet, theater critic, and mathematician. He was also the chief librarian of the Great Library of Alexandria. And one day, while reading a papyrus book in the library, he came upon a curious account. Far to the south, he read, at the frontier outpost of Syene, something notable could be seen on the longest day of the year. On June 21st, the shadows of a temple column or a vertical stick would grow shorter as noon approached. And as the hours crept towards midday, the sun's rays would slither down the sides of a deep well, which on other days would remain in shadow. And then, precisely at noon, columns would cast no shadows, and the sun would shine directly down into the water of the well. At that moment, the sun was exactly overhead. It was an observation that someone else might easily have ignored. Sticks, shadows, reflections in wells, the position of the sun. Simple, everyday matters of what possible importance might they be. But Eratosthenes was a scientist, and his contemplation of these homely matters changed the world. In a way, made the world. Because Eratosthenes had the presence of mind to experiment, to actually ask whether, back here near Alexandria, a stick cast a shadow near noon on June the 21st. And it turns out, sticks do. An overly skeptical person might have said that the report from Syene was in error, but it's an absolutely straightforward observation. Why would anyone lie on such a trivial matter? Eratosthenes asked himself how it could be that at the same moment a stick in Syene would cast no shadow and a stick in Alexandria, 800 kilometers to the north, would cast a very definite shadow. Here's a map of ancient Egypt. I've inserted two sticks or obelisks, one up here in Alexandria and one down here in Syene. Now, if at a certain moment each stick casts no shadow at all, that's perfectly easy to understand, provided the earth is flat. If the shadow at Syene is at a certain length, and the shadow at Alexandria is the same length, that also makes sense on a flat earth. But how could it be, Eratosthenes asked, that at the same instant there was no shadow at Syene, and a very substantial shadow at Alexandria? The only answer was that the surface of the earth
is curved. Not only that, but the greater the curvature, the bigger the difference in the lengths of the shadows. The sun is so far away that its rays are parallel when they reach the earth. Sticks at different angles to the sun's rays will cast shadows at different lengths. For the observed difference in the shadow lengths, the distance between Alexandria and Syene had to be about 7 degrees along the surface of the earth. By that I mean, if you imagine these sticks extending all the way down to the center of the earth, they would there intersect at an angle of about 7 degrees. Well, 7 degrees is something like a...
So how could Carl have made this even better, the story, to have somebody prove it to themselves? Open-ended question? Yep, that's one way. Yep, how else? Yep, open-ended question is a fantastic way. Yep, how else? If he'd... Put the listeners for yes. If he'd given them the board, right, Mark? If he'd given them the board, let them demonstrate to themselves. Have you guys all heard about the story about the guy who sold, I think it was like almost 10 times more safety glass when it first came out than everybody else? And they couldn't figure out how he did it. How did he sell 10 times more safety glass for Corning than any other? Yes, he gave them the hammer. That's right. He gave them the hammer. So that's it. But see how powerful this story is? If he started doing mathematical equations and all those kind of things, would he convince anybody? But when you do it with that story there and then with a piece of cardboard and two sticks, it becomes less or more believable at that point. How hard would that be to explain away? Does that make sense? So Mike sent me an article about a book that Carl Sagan wrote many years ago. And in it, he had a chapter called the Baloney Detection Kit, Carl Sagan's Rules for BS Busting and Critical Thinking. And it's amazing how people use many of these things to discount what we say. So we want to look at these things, the Baloney Detection Kit that everybody has, and how they use it to discount what we're saying. So they use, we're going to talk about critical thinking, and it's amazing that when people want to discount what we say, many of them will actually use these critical thinking tools to discount it. So here are 6 tips to becoming a better critical thinker. Accept that you always may not be right. Accept that you always may not be right. Is that important for us when we're talking to our clients? Because if we go on with the attitude, we're right, we're right, we're right, what's the likelihood we're going to get them to believe us? They're going to push back. They're boomers. They're going to push back. Do your research. Well, obviously, we do our research. Collaborate with other critical thinkers. Question assumptions. We're going to talk about all these things in more detail. Know your biases and think in reverse. So we're going to talk about these things. So again, the book that has this chapter, the Baloney Detection Kit, is The Demon-Haunted World, Science is a Candle in the Dark. How to Detect Baloney, the Carl Sagan style. So the Baloney Detection Kit, the kit is brought out as a matter of course whenever new ideas are offered for consideration. So are we bringing new ideas out to our clients? Are we bringing new ideas to our clients? Yes. We're bringing the idea. What's the main idea that we bring to our clients? What's the main idea that we bring to our client? What do we want them to leave with? Have we done a 21-point checklist right? That's right. David got it. If we do a 21-point checklist right, what's the one thing that we want them to tell us? Okay, everybody's getting it. Their advisor is taking advantage of them as disrespect. That's right. Everybody's getting it. Fantastic. If the new idea survives examination by the tools in our toolkit, we grant it a warm, although tentative, acceptance. So if you're so inclined, if you don't want to buy baloney, even when it's reassuring to do so, there are precautions that can be taken. And these are the things that people will do. So independent confirmation of facts. Do we use independent to help these people change their mind, to help these people come to a new conclusion? Do we use, one of the things for critical thinking is independent confirmation of facts. Do we use, that's right, Morningstar, right, Nick? We use Morningstar. We use Morningstar. Arguments from authority carry very little weight. Remember, these people are from the 60s. What do they think about authority? They don't trust it. So why do we have them tell us Morningstar is an independent, believable piece of information? Because if they say it, it's true. If we try to tell them Morningstar is the foremost entity and blah, 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 you should believe it, it is not going to work. They don't believe it. So that's the importance of them telling you that they can believe Morningstar. That's why we have to go through, you know, if you're going to choose a car, what kind of website would you go to? The Ford website? No, of course not. That's why you have to go through that, so that they tell themselves that Morningstar is an independent entity that they can believe. Because if you just tell them, hey, Morningstar is an authority, what will they tell you about that at the end of your argument? What will they tell you about Morningstar? If you tell them that Morningstar is an authority, what will they tell you about Morningstar? Yeah, it's not. That's right. So you can't tell them there's authority. All right, I'm right, you're wrong, shut up. Again, that's what I did when I was making 50 grand a year. Hey, listen, I'm a CFP. I'm a financial advisor. I know what's going on. You don't. So let me show you. Did that work for me? No. Yeah, I won every battle, lost every war. Encourage debate and evidence. Do we do that? Do we encourage debate on evidence? Yes, we do. Now, we walk through the whole thing about turnover. How would turnover affect a company? Why would it affect a company that way? Well, if it affects a company that way, why would it affect a portfolio that way? So we walk through, we say, why? Go ahead, debate me on this. Tell me why. Tell me my assumptions are wrong. We allow them to debate. We encourage the debate on evidence. Think of all the reasons that could explain it. For example, with titling script, do we tell them why the advisor use the wrong form for titling? No. Instead, we phrase it what? What do we tell him? Heck, I don't know why he didn't use the right form. You know, we weren't there. We don't know what's going on in his mind. He may have had a brain fart. Maybe he was having a bad day. Maybe he'd run out of the form. We don't know why he did this. So let's walk through this, and then we walk through the logic, right? But do we ever tell him that this is the reason it happened, or do we let them discover for themselves all the reasons that something could have happened? We let them discover it for themselves. So do you see how the 21-point checklist, the motivation interviewing, just asking questions isn't going to work? Are we walking through it in a critical thinking way, or having them, assisting them, facilitating them to walk through it in a critical thinking manner on why these things are happening? Do we do that or do we not do that with 21-point checklist and the motivational system interviewing? Yeah, we do. Don't get overly attached to your belief. So if they don't say it, it isn't true. Now, this applies to you. Don't get overly attached to your belief. One of the biggest mistakes, and Jeff, I want you to chirp in here. One of the biggest mistakes I see guys make is when they don't use motivational interviewing, or they ask close-ended questions, when the people say yes, guess what the advisor believes? They believe that, oh, they get it. They know what I'm talking about. They're agreeing with me. And what do we find out, Jeff, when our advisors just believe that they know what's going on in the client's minds instead of having the client say it? He's trying to find the unmute button.
Well, what you find out is it's probably not true. When you find out is at the end when they say, well, we need to think about it. And really what they're saying is, I need to replay what you said in your head when I get home and see if it still makes sense. Too often, and the problem then is that, well, now I can't go back. I don't know what they're doubting or where they lost me. It could have been 10 minutes in, it could have been 20 minutes in, it could have been 30 minutes in. I have no idea, because all along the way, they were saying, yep. And it's usually what happens is you guys are explaining it, saying, so you can see that you need to be between 10 and 60%, right? Right. And really, if we want to be in the green on this chart, we should probably be around 30, right? Right. We don't know what they're really thinking there.
And even if they do agree with you, right? That's perfectly said, Jeff. Even if they agree with you, though, how long does that last?
Not at all. The analogy we use is, we've all done it. I've been in a math class where the teacher is saying, okay, well, here's step one. Does everybody get that? And I was like, yeah, I get it. Here's step two. Do you get that? Yeah, I get it. Here's step three. Do you get it? Yeah, I get it. Then I go home to do the homework, and I don't get it. I thought I did, but because I'm just passive listening, I'm not really getting it. I'm not lying. I have no incentive to lie. I wanted to get it. I thought I got it. I just didn't. It doesn't last. It's not, because you're not actively doing it, it doesn't stay in your brain.
So guys, how do we get it to stay in their brain?
You get them to explain it to you. If they can explain it to you, then they can explain it to themselves and anybody else.
And it's going to stay way longer. Yep, exactly right. Thanks, Jeff. So this applies to you, the advisor. Don't get attached to your belief that they get what you're saying, that they agree with what you're saying. Don't ever – how many minutes go by before I question whether they believe me or not, guys? Yeah, that's right. 2 to 5 questions per minute. That's right. So I'm asking – I think not 30 seconds goes by where I don't – think they're not believing me. So I have to ask them, do you believe me or not? And I do that by having them answer an open-ended question. Be specific and quantify. That's critical thinking. So with the power of attorney, we just said, hey, power of attorney doesn't work with Social Security. That's a problem. Is that specific? They'd say what? Well, that's interesting. I guess I need to take care of that. Do they have any clue the kind of problems they would have because Social Security does not honor their power of attorney? Do they have any clue the problems could occur? No. So that's right, most attorneys don't even know that. So we have to walk through that story. You have to walk through that story so the light bulb goes on and says, whoa, I hadn't even thought about that. Whoa, if that happened to me, that would be terrible. Whoa, if that happened to me, my wife would be up the creek. So you have to have them quantify the problem that would occur. Does that make sense? How about fees? Do we quantify with fees? Or do you say you're paying too much? And what's the most visceral way we quantify their fees, guys? What's the most visceral way we quantify their fees? See if anybody gets this. Tangible, concrete way, visceral way we have them tally the fees. This way, how many of you use this? Kevin's got it. So Kevin, do you use it? Okay, so he doesn't. Does anybody use the cigar box with the cash in it? Mark Young does, great. So Mark, when you count out those $100 bills, I don't care how much money they have. When you count out those $100 bills, does that affect the person sitting across the desk from you? Yeah, it's a drop jaw. Exactly right, guys. When you tell somebody with money that they're going out to eat when they want, drive the car they want, going on vacation they want. And you tell them, boy, you're paying $7,300 too much in fees. Guess what they think? When you tell them that, show it to them, and they get it. Well, no, they get it. They see it. It's with Morningstar. They see it. But what do they think about that $7,300? Well, I'd agree, Tom. Tom says it's not real. I guess here's what I think is happening. I mean, I showed a lady how she could spend or save $28,000 a year in taxes. $28,000 a year in taxes before I created this system. I mean, she was one of the reasons I created this system, because when you show somebody how to save $28,000 in taxes, you'd think they'd be overwhelmed and jump on board, right? She stayed where she was at. Why did she stay where she was at? She was living the life she wanted. You probably heard me talk about her before. We were in a small town in Minnesota. She was had the money at the bank, and she went on the banking tours, you know, where they go to a brewery and then a knitting factory. Once a month, they went on little trips. That was our whole social and entertainment that she did besides gardening. So that extra $28,000, did that affect her? No. So she's like, well, you understand. So when you show somebody who's living the life that they're paying $7,300 in fees, they're saying, yeah, we should deal with that. We should have something, you know what? But it's really not affecting our life right now. We're still doing all the things we want. Because is that a tangible, concrete number, or is that a intangible number, that 7,300? How do you change that 7,300 from intangible to tangible? Man, when you start counting out $100 bills right in front of them, as Mark said, their jaw drops. I don't care if they're worth $5 million. When you count out $7,300 bills, no, I didn't have $7,300 bills. What I would do, if it was $7,300, I had $3,500 in a box. And I would just take that $3,500. I'd want to throw the $3,500 in front of them. So obviously, if I only have $3,500 and they're paying $7,300 too much in taxes, I would tell them, in fees, what would I tell them? Every six months, this is what's happening. Somebody walks up to your door, knocks on the door, knock, knock, knock. They say hi and say, okay, I'm here for our semi-annual meeting. Here's your money. And I count out those $100 bills. $100, $200, $300, $400, $500, $600, $700, $800, $900, $1,000. $100, $200, $300, $400, $500, $600, $700, $800, $900, $1,000. $100, $200, $300, $400, $500, $600, $700, $800, $900, $1,000. $1, $2, $3, $4, $5. And then I put it right in front of them. $35, $100 bills. Did I have their attention, guys? Did I change that money from an intangible, an abstract, into concrete, into reality? Did I have their attention? Yes. Now, that money they were losing was real money or abstract money every 6 months? Everybody answer this. Real or abstract? Yeah, it's real. That closed so many deals. Because immediately they say, so do I get to keep that money? And then I always reach for it. What would I do? I'd grab it because I'd shove that money to them and then I would pull it back. What else am I doing when I have it in front of them and I pull it back? Why do salespeople want you to handle something and then take it away from you? Because you didn't even want that thing until it was in your hands. And once it's in your hands, you want what? Oh my God, give me that thing back. Does that make sense? So am I being specific in quantifying with that? Yes. So all through the 21-point checklist, we are being very specific in quantifying. Every link of your argument chain must work. You cannot skip steps. So when we do tape reviews once a month, do we often find advisors skip steps in the script? And what happens when they skip steps? Good things or bad things? See, that we build this, all of these scripts have been built on like a house of cards. If you have to have a solid foundation, another solid foundation, another solid foundation, a foundation, foundation. If any one of those levels is not solid, what's going to happen? It's going to fall apart. Yeah, the car with three wheels. Occam's razor. The simplest explanation is usually the best explanation. So with our bond script, is it one? And I have some guys tell me, well, you know, that's not exactly how bonds work. It's basically how bonds work. It's not exactly how bonds work. Why do we just go through the basics of that when interest rates go up, bond values go down? Why don't we go through the basics that if you have two bonds and interest rates go up 1%, the bond's going to go down 33% in value. Why do we go through it like that? How long would it take to go through the actuality of exactly the mathematics that would work based on bond rating, based on callability, based on everything else that it had? What would happen? Yeah, 6 weeks, exactly right. So we used a simple explanation. So what? They get it. They get the point. Interest rates go up, bond values go down, and they don't go down a little. They can go down what? A lot. And we got into bonds for safety, or we got into bonds for something to go down a lot? We got into bonds for safety. Why didn't he tell us this? Why did he hide this from us? Because the things that are guaranteed that don't go down, how much does he make on that? Nothing. So that makes sense? We use simple explanations so people can get it. Ask, can this conclusion be false? Do we ever use the devil's advocate on this in the 21-point checklist? Do we ever say, but I'm confused, and why would you want to do this then? I'm confused about titling. I mean, why would the company let you park their money there after your death? When you play the devil's advocate, what does that force them to do it? Do. When you play the devil's advocate, what does it force them to do? Argue the true point. Argue the truth. So you'll throw up, hey, well, what about this? And it makes them argue the truth. So we say, well, can this conclusion be false? And they'll say, no, it's not because the company is not allowing us to park money there. They're, because they're being nice. The company wants us to park the money there so they can make money on us. See, by me playing the devil's advocate and saying, well, why does the company, you know, nice enough to let you park the money there after you die? And when you do that, people, do the clients say, well, of course, they're not allowing me to park it there. They make money when I'm leaving it there. Do they say that? And there's all sorts of places that we play the devil's advocate here to make them argue the truth of the situation. Defense mechanism. We want the client to, or we want to avoid a client having a defense mechanism. So here's how the clients will defend themselves. So that's how, these are all the critical thinking skills. Now I want to go into a little bit that if you do it wrong, what do clients tend to do when you do the scripts wrong? They'll what? Argue. That's right. They'll defend themselves. They have a defense mechanism. They don't want to look stupid. And admitting that you're right would say, I've been making stupid decisions. They don't want to admit that. So all these defense mechanisms are going to kick in if you don't do it right. The funny thing is, though, if you do it right, these do not kick in. But let's look at some of these defense mechanisms and ask yourself, have I seen these in a meeting? So clients, logic killers. To the man. Argument. Let me try it again. Attacks the person and the person's character, not the issue. Have you ever heard something like, well, you don't get paid? You know, when you try to point out the fees and that they're paying unnecessarily, this used to happen to me all the time when I was making 50 grand a year. The client would say, what, you're doing it for free? You don't get paid? So when I point out the other guy getting paid, did they get mad at the other guy or who'd they get mad at when I was doing all the talking? Who are they getting mad at? Yeah, they're getting mad at me. What, you work for free? Why are you attacking my advisor getting paid? You get paid too, don't you? See, so they'll attack you. Have you ever experienced anything like that? Then you know I'm doing something wrong here because they're attacking you. The other thing they'll do is they'll respect authority. Have you ever been told that, well, my guy, you know, he's very well respected at the bank and, you know, he's considered one of the top advisors at the company and he's got all these different degrees. You know, he spoke at a national conference and brr, 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 brr. So they actually use authority. See, they use logic in a manner that fits them. In one case, they'll say, I don't believe Morningstar because you say it's an authority. On the other hand, they'll say, hey, my guy has a lot of authority. Same client would say, I don't believe that authority, but my guy has authority. I believe him. So are human beings logical? No. They were logical. They wouldn't say, I don't believe that authority, but I believe this authority. If you don't believe authority, then guess what? Yeah, people are crazy. That's right. So that's another logic killer to throw in your way. We just kind of covered this one. Do you work for free? Appeal to ignorance. The claim that whatever has not been proved false must be true, and vice versa. That is, there is no compelling evidence that UFOs are not visiting Earth. Therefore, UFOs exist. You say UFOs don't exist. Well, how do you know? There's no evidence that UFOs don't exist on Earth. So do they use things like that? You can't prove that this is happening. They'll use odd things like that. You don't understand, and I can't explain. So this is the most frustrating thing. If you don't do the scripts right, that's why we go with baby steps in logical order, because if you don't do this, when they start falling back to this, you don't understand, but I can't explain why. How hard is that to fight against, guys? Turnover is not bad. Why is it not bad? Well, I can't explain, but you know what? They obviously wouldn't be turning over socks if they, you know, why would they want to keep bad socks? So obviously we want them to turn over socks because we don't want them to keep bad socks. Well, yeah, but should they have bought the right stocks to begin? Well, you know what? Things change, don't they? You're telling me things don't change? So when things change, they're being very flexible and they're making sure that they're up to speed. Well, year after year? Well, things change year after year, don't they? Where's that argument going, guys? Am I going to win that argument? No. Every time, it's like a balloon, right? When I squeeze the balloon here, what happens? Pops out somewhere else. So why do we go through these non-financial associated analogies first with all the scripts? We always talk about the non-financial. With turnover, we talk about, hey, would a company want employees being turned over all the time? For beneficiaries, they say, if we had a pie, we divide it by three. How many pieces would, or what percentage would each person get? So we go through those non-financial stories because it prevents them from having this circular argument. Does that make sense? Begging the question is also called assuming the answer. We must institute the death penalty to discourage violent crime. But does the violent crime rate, in fact, fall when death penalty is imposed? Or the stock market fell yesterday because of a technical adjustment and profit-taking by investors. But is there any independent evidence for the casual role of adjustment and profit-taking? Or is that just something they're throwing out there? Is that just keywords and tricky phrases they throw out there to explain things? Any of you guys read Freakonomics or listen to their podcast? How many quote-unquote logical – yes, we like to see patterns, Nick. So how many logical explanations does Freakonomics walk through and show are not actually logical and are actually the total opposite? But we like to see patterns, and they'll see patterns where there are no patterns. Observational selection, also called the enumeration of favorable circumstances. Philosopher Fred Smith described it as counting hits and forgetting the misses. So a state boasts that the president has produced, but it is silent about its serial killers. So the state says, Nebraska says, we produced five presidents, and they never talk about all their, you know, I'm just making that up, but all their serial killers. So yeah, it's confirmation bias. That's right. So have any of you ever had a client says, I can't sell now because the market's going up? Okay, then the market falls. What do they tell you? Okay, now we can sell. What do they tell you then? When the market falls, they want to sell then? Or they say, I can't sell till it comes back. We have these, they'll throw all sorts of illogical things, statistics of small numbers. They say, one out of five people is Chinese. How is that possible? I know hundreds of people and none of them is Chinese. I've thrown three sevens in a row. Tonight I can't lose. I've made money over the last 8 years, so therefore what? I'll give you a great example of this. In 1997, 98, 99, what was the stock market doing? Up a little or up like 20%, 20% plus, 20% plus? Yeah, through the roof. And I had a client call me and says, Mike, I don't get it. You told me I couldn't retire for 15 years. I can retire in 3 years. I was like, congratulations, David. That's awesome. Now, can you help me explain how you're going to retire in 3 years? Yeah, well, I did the math. And when I did the math, I'm going to have enough money to retire in 3 years. Well, what numbers was he using for the math on his accounts? Yeah, 25%. So what's the likelihood the market was going to go up 25 after it went up over 20% 3 years in a row? What was the likelihood it was going to go up another 3 years at 20%+? And this guy was my one and only doctor client. He was the head of OBGYN at the local hospital. He's my one and only doctor client. So he wasn't an idiot, but do idiots, even do people who are based in science, their jobs are based in science, still have blinders on when it comes to this kind of stuff? Yes. There are many more client, I mean, I could go on and on and on about client excuses. I could, we've all heard them, right? But what's the cure for client excuses? What's the cure for client excuses? The 5Q scripts and motivational interviewing. When you do it in the manner that we show you how to do it, you don't get those kind of mechanisms. And I know it seems onerous. I know it seems like we're plodding along and you think, I can make this point. Mike takes 8 minutes to make this point. I could make it in 30 seconds. Why do I take 8 minutes to make the point? Because I'm not making it. I'm having the client walk through non-financial analogies and saying that that's absolutely the God's honest truth. That's how things work. And then I have them work through their own situation so that they realize, oh, my situation is this way because my guy was taking advantage of me. There's a reason for the way that we do things. This is the cure to getting them to go from loving their guy in the morning to knowing that he's taking advantage of them, not a little, but a lot, by the end of a two-hour meeting. Does that make sense? We help. That's right. We help them connect the dots, Ron. So it's we walk through, we facilitate their own critical thinking mechanisms. We cannot do the critical thinking for them. We must let them make the critical thinking decisions. We use it with Socratic logic in the 5Q scripts, and we have them do the Socratic logic for us by using motivational interviewing. So therefore, they're using Socratic logic to convince us. We're not convincing them. They convince us and they convince themselves that their guy is taking advantage of them. Make sense? Super. Well, thanks for being on today. I hope this wasn't too out there for you. Do you guys are okay with a theory like this on an occasional basis? Awesome possum. You guys, appreciate all of you. You guys have a fantastic rest of the week, and we'll talk to you all next Monday. Thanks, everybody.